Welcome to the BioBalance Healthcast, episode number 302, The Psychology of Weight Loss and Maintaining Ideal Weight.
BioBalance Healthcast features conversations about positive aging. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, Medical Director of BioBalance Health and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor. Dr. Maupin and Brett are the authors of The Secret Female Hormone, the seminal work about hormone replacement therapy for women, which is available on Amazon or from Dr. Maupin's office at BioBalance Health. Dr. Maupin's office is currently accepting new patients.
Everywhere you look, you find information that says obesity is a chronic problem in America. I've seen studies recently that say almost 50% of Americans are technically obese. Mm-hmm. The insurance companies have changed the weight limits for the categories, and the federal government's changed the diet plan. You know, the pyramid's gone to the plate, and everybody's all concerned about how we're going to lose weight. And we live in a culture that markets food that's mm-hmm. not healthy. But they make it look good, and they tell us we ought to have it, and we eat it. We learn, as children, so many of us learn that we belong to the Clean Your Plate Club. You know, your mother worked mm-hmm. real hard to fix that dinner for you, son. You're going to clean your plate because it's disrespectful if you don't. Money doesn't grow on trees. We bought that food. You need to eat it. And so we habit ourselves mm-hmm. to eat a certain amount. You go out to restaurants, and so many restaurants serve portions that are so huge. And older people, when they go out, often asked to split a dinner.
Because
and then,
the helpings are just
even
so
if
huge.
There's an upcharge. Right, because they're not going to eat all that food.
Right, know? They don't want to waste it. And I do that. I don't want to waste it.
Yeah, so our interactions with food, things about food, are significantly complicated. But also our self-image, the message that we need to look a certain way in order to be attractive or in order to be successful. Even kids in grade school are harassed about their weight. They're called names, they're bullied, they're made fun of, they're laughed at. And that continues through adolescence and into adulthood. And mm-hmm. in adulthood, it actually is a sort of a hidden form of discrimination for many jobs. If you apply for a job, you show up and you are what they call...
morbidly obese.
Yeah, morbidly obese. But you just don't fit with their culture, you know, they're not going to hire you. You don't mm-hmm. get the job. You don't get the promotion. Mm-hmm. There are assumptions made. And so you have an extra hill to climb and able to prove yourself in terms of capacity or ability or performance.
Or energy.
And energy. So we are preoccupied with the concept of how do we lose weight and how do we maintain the weight that we lose down to, if indeed we do lose. And what we have come to believe, Dr. Maupin and I, is that so much of the difficulty that people have with diets, with dieting, with weight maintenance, with weight establishment, has to do with being built on the wrong foundation. The solution to the problem doesn't start where it needs to start. There are solutions. There are things that work. There are things that you can do to drop weight, but you don't stay there. Generally, when people go on a diet and change the way that they eat, then when they reach their goal, they come off the diet, mm-hmm. then they go right back to the way that they used to eat, and pretty soon they've put all that weight back on plus so many pounds, 5 or 10 right. usually. So what we've learned, what people tell everybody, is that you can't diet to lose weight. You need to change your interactions with food. You need to change your lifestyle. You need to figure out mm-hmm. an exercise plan. You need to figure out an eating plan. You need to figure out foods that, and they recommend, you know, like green vegetables and fruits and carbs and or proteins. And all of those things work some, but they don't work enough and they don't last. And the reason is they're built on the wrong foundation. So it's like building a building on quicksand. You put a good, strong foundation in there and then all of a sudden it tilts or it gets dropped down.
Or it sinks.
Or it sinks or falls apart. So what then is a good foundation? What do you need to be the basis of your approach to maintenance of weight, establishment of weight, good self-esteem, high levels of energy, good health, so that you can live a functional and happy life and not be caught up in our cultural issues around weight and weight management to your detriment? So what is the answer?
I've gone through, you know, diet of the month club. Everybody comes in. Right. Here's this diet. What do you think of that? Well, here's this diet. What do you think of that? Well, no diet is going to be something that I'm going to look at and say, this is great for everybody because everyone has different needs.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So
different
the
metabolisms,
first,
different cultural,
different genetics,
right.
Different activity level. They, and I go also by blood type. I also go by their blood work. If they have prediabetes, their diet's going to be something different than someone who doesn't. So when I'm looking at the patient and they say, oh, I've got this new diet. Well, none of those fad diets are going to work for everyone. They may work for a small part of the population,
right.
And it may work for a while, and then you flip back to your non-ideal weight. So what I did was I looked at all of the different programs that are out there.
Mm-hmm.
Some are food-based. Some are exercise-based. Some are psychologically based. Some are diet pill-based. Like the HCG diet or diet medication. And I went through that and I looked for being the problem solver, which is makes me a pain in the butt to everybody I know. It being the problem solver I
that's
am.
That's a problem she hadn't solved.
That's gosh, right. So I just can't look at something and go, oh yeah, well, we're gonna do that without a darn good reason because I don't wanna fail. So when we put our diet program together, I looked at every weight loss program and said, why does this fail on everything?
Right.
Why doesn't it last? And why don't people reach their ideal goal before they stop? So what I did was realize that, first of all, you need the basis. The foundation is we need to find out what your metabolic problems are. We need to find out why you can't lose weight, what those issues are, and we do that with blood work and history. So we have to talk to you, find out your history, do your blood work, and then I know what your individual problems are. Then we find out what your food cravings are. That usually gives us a sign as to what kind of problems you have with sticking to a healthy, really healthy diet.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have to go through diet programs that will actually work for a lifetime, real food. And sometimes we add a protein shake here and there just for people who may not eat meat or for their specific needs.
Right.
That's okay. But diets that are all shakes, that's not going to translate into weight loss because you can't go to real food. You don't know how. And you feel hungry when you're eating. You go from shakes to real food. So your weight loss just goes away. So I looked at all of those. I looked at just the exercise programs. Exercise programs for fat loss, because when you exercise, you build muscle, supposedly. They may work for somebody who's 40, up to 40. But after 40, most of us don't have enough testosterone to build muscle and lose fat. So that's a hormonal issue. So we have to fix that. Then we have to find the medications that work best with that person. And then this one thing, we need a coach. A really good invested coach in your success.
Mm-hmm.
So somebody who has your best interests in you succeeding. Now, if you look at all the different weight loss centers, you're going to find one of those things like Weight Watchers has the coaching, but they process food. You don't know how to cook for it. So that's one, you know, so they all have a problem. We took this and said, the foundation is metabolism and getting your hormones back to normal and your metabolic rate back to normal.
Maybe hormones and neurotransmitters.
And neurotransmitters like epi in your norepinephrine in your brain and mm-hmm. serotonin. And that may take supplements or it may take hormones.
Mm-hmm.
But the neurotransmitters are dependent on your hormones too in your brain.
So you're saying that the foundation that allows all these other systems to have a positive impact is that you have to get your hormones to the right balance and you have to get your neurotransmitters to the right balance.
Mm-hmm.
And if your body is then stable,
your metabolism is working.
Then you can diet and exercise and then you can use things like psychological counseling mm-hmm. to good benefit.
Mm-hmm.
But
and that's the hardest thing is to find that coach
right.
who's really good. I right. mean, my nurse practitioners are great at this.
Mm-hmm.
They take on the weight of their patient
mm-hmm.
and they live it. You know, they feel terrible if they come in and they're frustrated and they don't lose weight. You know, so they are really trying to get this person to be successful. Their success is my nurse's success.
Sure.
And my physician partner in Kansas City, Dr. Sullivan has amazing results because she is so invested in that patient.
Right.
We've even added HCG diet, not the way they do it with 800 calories, but HCG plus all of these other parts.
It's a seven-step program that you guys have put together.
Yes.
And it begins with the premise that you get your hormones balanced.
Mm-hmm.
When your hormones are balanced, then if you do these seven things together, not necessarily hierarchically, but all of these things.
And that's right. Don't just do one and then stop and do another. Yeah. That doesn't work. You have to get everything together. It's a huge process, but it pays off.
So the first one is get your hormones balanced, your neurotransmitters balanced by using correct supplements and treatments. You will need to see a physician who knows about this kind of medicine. Not every physician knows about hormone balances. I mean, they've studied them, but it isn't their focus. It isn't what they do most of the time. They're not as intricately knowledgeable for different genetic structures or for different issues.
Or metabolic problems. They can't detect them.
Metabolic problems, exactly.
I mean, I was, when my, after I had my hysterectomy, I gained 20 pounds in, I don't know, a couple weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And I clearly had had a head injury. I had had some problems with surgery and ended up in the unit. So I had clearly had a head injury and I'd had some hormonal imbalances, which I went to an endocrinologist and they told me basically I was eating too much and I wasn't eating at all. And that all my abnormalities were secondary to surgery. They'd get better all by themselves. And that I was just being lazy because I couldn't exercise. Well, so that was terrible advice.
So they come in at the middle. And so many of these, like you talk about anorexia or bulimia or some of the other eating disorders, there are several others. If you just try to treat that from where the patient is and you don't address their hormone balances, you don't deal with the anxiety, the depression, the self-esteem. I mean, all of those things have to be dealt with, but they won't typically be successfully dealt with until after you get your hormones balanced.
Right. But if your doctor says, when they say, you need to lose weight, and then they walk out of the room, and I'm very compassionate to doctors not having enough time with their patients and insurance companies running their lives, but you can't really tell a patient to lose weight and then leave the room. I mean, it's a huge conversation, and it obviously takes a lot of evaluation.
And it takes more than a judgmental observation by a physician. You're going to die if you don't lose some weight. Well, that may be a truism, but it's not going to help.
But that's scary, and fear does not motivate people.
No.
It just doesn't. It makes people shut down.
I mean, for a little while, it might. You know.
Yeah. I mean, it does for a little while, maybe, in some people, not most.
Yeah.
And, you know, the fear of dying goes away after a while.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go, oh, that pizza looks really good. You know, and there's really nothing wrong with pizza as long as you don't eat half the pizza, you know. So, but having said that.
Clean your plate club.
Yeah. Again, I mean, you know? And if that's all you're eating and you have a salad, that's not terrible.
Or when you
it's just how
you don't pay attention to what you're eating.
Yeah.
I mean, there are a whole lot of psychological strategies that
and that's
can
why
be
you're
used
here.
And do work for people trying to lose weight or retrain their bodies to eat differently. But we want you to go through this in order for it to work. So the second of the seven steps is engage a monitoring health professional. It doesn't have to be a physician. It can be a nurse or a nurse practitioner. It can even be a counselor if they're knowledgeable in these areas.
Mm-hmm.
But somebody that will work with you and monitor your progress.
And take on the responsibility with you of your weight loss.
In your exercise and diet plan. One that understands metabolism and can offer advice about what will work for your particular metabolism.
Right.
So somebody that can track and have some idea of where your difficulties are going to be, you're going to have a problem with sugar. We need to retrain you as far away from sugar as we can get you, as consistently as we can get you, knowing that you're still going to have some.
You
can't eat food in America without getting sugar.
No, you can't. But if you stop added sugar, that helps.
Right.
And we use medication like metformin and Victoza and Saxenda. Those are medications we use to help somebody who has almost diabetes or early diabetes or insulin resistance, which makes them, all of those make you gain weight, have that treated. So then their metabolism can come back to normal, and then whatever they eat doesn't make fat. Because that's what happens when you're pre-diabetic. You just, whatever you eat doesn't make energy, you're exhausted, and it makes fat instead. So we do use medication. That's why it has to be a medical plan. That's why it has to be something that a medical physician or nurse practitioner is actually working with you on.
And self-image is a real important component. I mean, there are things that you can do to enhance your self-image. You can do things like liposuction, or you can do things with lasers, or you can do things with surgeries, like bariatric surgery. I mean, some of those things are life-saving, and they give you a chance to make progress, but you have to do the rest of it. So many people that I have known who've had bariatric surgery eat their way out of it because they haven't changed their behaviors.
That's like stomach stapling or putting a ring around the stomach to make it smaller or removing part of the stomach. That's what bariatric surgery is.
And I've had clients of mine who have done that. And I think at the time, I haven't kept up with it, so I'm not sure. They had to be like 150 pounds overweight in order to qualify for the surgery.
For insurance to pay for it.
Because it's a morbid threat. I mean, you can die.
You can die of the surgery, but you could die of not having the surgery.
Exactly.
And it's an answer for some people, but what they forget
is the hormone balance.
Is the hormone balance and the post-surgical training.
Yes.
Most programs, and I'm not saying all, but most programs do the bariatric surgery, and surgeons they're focused. They're focused on the surgery. They have to be. I mean, I'm half surgeon, half medical doctor. I mean, I used to operate at least one day a week. And when you're doing surgery, your whole brain changes and you're focused on what needs to be fixed. And then here are the orders. See you later. Mm-hmm. Basically, it's an in and out. And that's why some people are really so good at that. They don't want to follow people forever. Mm-hmm. Okay. But you need following if you've had bariatric surgery. You need to have the right vitamins, the right hormonal milieu, the right probiotics to make your intestines work normally.
And when you're angry and depressed and upset, you need somebody to talk to about it. Somebody that, and this is item number three, engage a professional who has a non-judgmental attitude about you and who can help you develop such an attitude about yourself. You cannot just focus on negative self-esteem and negative hatred and punish yourself around food because you won't make it. You won't get where you need to go.
That's the opposite effect.
Yes. You need to get somebody that can work with you on that, that your feeling is they respect me, they see the inner me, they help me structure the outer me in the best way that they can or the best way that I can. But you need somebody literally and figuratively to hold your hand through that process.
Right. That's right.
Because you're not going to make it alone. I mean, all the data shows. There are rare examples, at least in the short term. But in the long term, you aren't going to make it unless you change the way you live. And you can't change the way you live unless your hormones are in balance to begin with. If you don't have that solid foundation, you're not building on solid ground. If you build on quicksand, you're going to go back to problems.
I've been in so many of these different programs myself to...
Well, you study them and try them because...
Well, I try them. I wanted to be skinnier than I probably should have been.
Well, my wife wants to be a tall, willowy blonde.
Okay, so that's...
I tell her, you can be blonde.
That's a problem that many women have, and I remember having it as a teenager. You know, I wanted to look like Twiggy. Well, with my muscle mass and stuff, yeah, I'm never going to look like Twiggy. I mean, at any age, and unless I had cancer and I was dying, I might look like Twiggy and I would not look good. So that was a poor vision of myself. The best advice I can give you is when you have somebody who is your goal, like if you're and there's nothing wrong with saying, I want to look like that person, but they've got to be the same height and they've got to have the same type of build. Either they're mesomorphic, like they have muscle, they're ectomorphic, where they have a lot of, for women, a lot of fat, kind of this hourglass kind of figure, but normal weight, or they're, you know, tall and skinny and straight. I mean, those are the three body types. Pick somebody with your own body type. That's the first step. Before you adore someone that you want to be like, you have to have a reachable goal.
Ectomorph, endomorph, and mesomorph.
Right.
So then step number four, establish a protocol that requires accountability to someone for your weight loss and behavior patterns. Someone capable of explaining your program in ways that help you achieve your goals. So you need to be able to check in with somebody on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. Not about, today I sinned, today I ate a candy bar.
And that doesn't help at all.
No, you can't track it that way. But somebody that can track what's your resistance to exercising. You haven't exercised 3 days this week. How are you doing with your weight maintenance? How are you doing with your diet?
Time management, so you can do all this stuff.
Yes.
How do you get your food ready? I mean, I talk to people all the time and say, I just don't have time to use real food.
Right.
And I'm like, well, I always had time to use real food. When I was delivering babies, had a full practice, and I mean, not home a lot, taking care of a family, I did all my cooking on Sunday afternoon. So go to the store, make everything for the whole week,
you can do that.
Put it in the fridge or the freezer.
But you also need somebody to help you understand how to shop from menus, how to prepare your meals, how to not have quick sugar-based snacks at home that you can just go to.
I like Blue Apron and HelloFresh.
These are food production companies.
Yeah, you don't even go to the store for those if you're so busy. They deliver kits of how many meals at that one night you want. So you have kits and they have instructions and you can just, 20 minutes, you're done. It's all there and it's healthy and it's organic.
So you develop strategies to counteract that. You go to the grocery store and you say, I'm just going to this aisle, I'm going to get these two things and come home. Because if you go up and down the aisles, and they've done marketing studies, I mean, they track your eyes. As you walk with hidden cameras, as you walk down a grocery aisle, and they can tell what you hesitate for, where you hesitate, where you look. And then they get the stores to put their products at the place where most people look. And they package their products for the symbols that they've studied. I can't remember the name of the margarine, but there was a margarine that had a large clover, four-leaf clover, on the packaging. And the packaging was gold or silver, and they had this big four-leaf clover. Mm-hmm. It attracted people. And so they would buy that margarine because visually it reached out
to them. Without looking at the price?
And without looking at the comparative margarines for price per unit or flavor.
And now we don't eat margarine.
Right. but the stores also, to prevent, you know, it's always a chess game. So to prevent you from being able to go in and shop to your menu and just get what you need and get out, they rearrange the store. So the bread used to be over here, it gets moved over here. The canned goods used to be here, they get moved over here. The coffee used to be here, gets moved over here. So you have to go up and down every aisle to find what you want because they know you will impulse buy.
They're trying to outplay you.
They see these display items, these end cap items, and they're mostly sugared sodas,
cereal.
Diet products, not diet products, but like snack products, chips, candies, cakes, ice creams. I mean, ice cream, they have a big section for ice cream, but then on the end cap, they'll put a freezer and put more ice cream.
Right.
You know, or booze.
So you'll just pick it up as you go.
So you pick it up because you're close to the register and it's like, oh, that looks good. Ben and Jerry's, I want that.
So basically what we do with this, you know, having someone who's accountable for you, they'll help you devise strategies for what is your problem.
Right.
Do you have a problem with the store? Do you have a problem with organizing your time? Do you have a problem with being hungry for certain things?
Right.
Then
what do you crave?
What do you crave? So then we substitute things for that so that you have something to do instead of what you want to do. Change your taste. I've done this before. I get a little like sugars or carb hungry.
Yeah.
Then it blows my whole diet and I'm starving for carbs all the time. So you have to replace those carbs with something else. So that I can then not be starved for carbs. I don't want them anymore. 2 weeks without overt carbs, you don't really care about them anymore.
Well, and then there are other strategies you can use at home. Once you've gotten your groceries and gotten home, you know, get rid of your 14-inch plates.
Right.
Use 10-inch plates. Mm-hmm. Don't put a big bucket of food on the table. Leave it on the stove and serve your plate from the stove. Put your fork down. Men especially, boys, have problems with it. They don't put their fork down when they eat. They hang their head over their plate and they just rotate. It's pack, shove, and wait. Pack, shove, and wait. And so as they swallow some down the back and a little bit of room opens up, I mean, you watch a teenage boy eat. That's how they eat. Mm-hmm. Don't sit in front of the television or read a book while you eat. Pay attention to your food behaviors. Pay attention to your food, the taste, the flavor, the look. Mm-hmm. Don't have the radio on. Don't have the TV on. Don't have a book in front of you. Just eat your meal. Set a full place setting at the table, even if you eat alone. Formalize your dinner. Formalize your food behavior. There are tricks that help. You need, and this is point number five, you need somebody that knows these things that can help you establish a linear sequenced plan for success in small steps. There is no magic button. There is no panacea that if you just do this for 2 weeks, you're going to drop 50 pounds. It's not, and keep it off. It's right. not going to happen.
And that plan has to be known by you and the person that makes you accountable.
Yes. How are you doing with setting your table? Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not doing very well this week. Well, what can we do to help you? You know, what if you said it the night before? What there mm-hmm. are things that they can engage you about. Item number six, if necessary, use real medicines to stimulate your metabolism. And these are the medicines that Dr. Maupin was talking about. They're not the diet pills from the 50s and 60s that were just amphetamines and would spin you up.
But we might use that.
You might use that.
For certain people,
but there are other
we might
things.
Use that.
Right, if it's appropriate right. metabolically. And then number seven, eat real food, not power shakes, and not total reliance on a single, like I'm on the grapefruit diet.
That's just ridiculous.
You need a plan for balance. And you need to work and you need to achieve it with the help of someone that cares about you, is non-judgmental and tracks you, that you're mm-hmm. accountable to, that you have conversations about. Not accountable to in the form of being subservient. They're the dictator and you're the punished bad behavior.
They're happy when you succeed.
Absolutely.
So and Dr. Sullivan in Kansas City has had an unbelievable result with her patients that she walks through this diet plan that right. we use. We use all these parts and she sees them once a month. And we've had one patient who I honestly, without adding that coaching, mm-hmm. couldn't budge her down very far. And Dr. Sullivan
was able to do the coaching.
Did the coaching and she lost 35 pounds in 3 months. I mean, that's a lot for someone who's 5'3" and has been resistant. So that part is very important.
But both components are in place. Mm-hmm. The hormones are balanced, the neurotransmitters are balanced, and then the diet plan that's structured for success that includes mm-hmm. all these things about exercise and monitoring and encouragement and teaching work. So if you are interested in losing weight, if you are interested in challenging your own obesity issues, whether you're obese or not by definition, then you need to think about A, getting your hormones balanced, mm-hmm. and B, working a plan such as the 7-step plan that we've just articulated.
Sign up with my nurse practitioners and Dr. Sullivan because they
That's
do
right.
great work.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.